call unto thee, O Lord, and send thou my life to guide us, for we are weak and afraid, and we lack knowledge.
There is no one to hear your plea, no one to answer you, no one to ease your suffering.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Hey, hey, welcome to the NY Patriot Show. Here we delve deep into the abyss, covering topics such as occultism, spirituality, secret societies, conspiracies, and the unknown. Join us in trying to put these pieces together and figuring all this shit out. The NY Patriot Show. Today I have a very special guest, somebody I always love having on, one of my favorite returning guests too. I have the OG, the original gangster of this shit. We got the Odd Man out today. Odd Man, you want to say what's up to everybody?
Hey man, thanks for having me on. I've been looking forward to this, and
well, definitely.
I don't know, man. It's going to be a fun show. I know it is. I know that with this subject, it's kind of controversial, but I think we're going to have some real fun with this.
Oh, yeah. No, I definitely think so. And I know I've had, like you even mentioned, I had Adam on not too long ago. I thought that was a great show, but, you know, maybe I don't. He's very one particular view. You know what I'm saying? And I think there's a little bit more to it. So I think this will be a completely different show as well. And I'm really.
I think so, man. I think so. I listened to that. It was a good show. And I honestly, I've only seen like two of his shows in the past. I knew who he was, but it was interesting for me to listen to that because I was already studying this and I was like, okay, it's kind of cool to get somebody else's perspective.
Yeah, I thought so. And I don't want to forget my favorite co-host, part-time co-host. We also have my favorite Canadian, Italian-Canadian is also.
Right.
my co-host on Spirit, well, I'm her co-host, really. It's her show, Spiritual Gangsters. So, Teresa, you want to just say what's up and let everybody know about your show as well?
Yeah, thanks for having me. Yeah, what's up? Not much is up, but I do have a show with you called The Spiritual Gangsters as well. So that's been fun. It's pretty new, but I think we've had some great talks on there. We had like a real banger episode come out this past Monday with Zachary King. That was pretty cool. And I think I've been getting a lot of good feedback on that. So guys should check it out if you haven't already, for sure. It's a wild one. Let's put it that way.
You know, and you know what's really weird that I just saw pop up on this? Odd Man, are you on Facebook?
Yeah.
Have you been banned or anything?
I haven't, no, but my Oddcast page has been limited. Like the audience is severely limited, so I barely do anything with it. I still do stuff on my personal page, but
it's telling
don't
me
get
now.
Much attention.
I normally stream to Facebook, and it's literally telling me right now that it's failed to post, and it's saying the username, the Odd Man Out, your contact, and your content cannot be shared because of community standards. So I'm like, it has anything to do with his name? Or I'm wondering, like, has my Facebook actually been taken down or something?
That's not good.
So, yeah, I got to check that out afterwards. But I was wondering, I was like, maybe Odd Man's name triggered something. Did he get banned?
It probably did.
That's fucked up. But all right. So, today, this morning, we're going to be talking about Zionism. It's a topic that I actually, believe it or not, don't know much about. So that's why I'm having you on again, because I want to hear a different perspective about it. And I'm pretty sure the listeners will enjoy it as well. So I guess without further ado, we'll just get going. And first, too, if you want, I mean, I'm sure anybody who's listened to my show already knows who the hell you are. But just in case people don't, you want to just let everybody know who you are and tell them where they can find you. I already put your links in the show notes for YouTube, but just if you want, let everybody know.
Yeah, man, thank you. So I do a show called The Oddcast, featuring the Odd Man Out. And I just kind of talk about a lot of different things, New World Order kind of stuff. I kind of get into esoteric stuff. The secret societies is kind of more my kind of, I wouldn't say expertise, but I enjoy that more than anything, I think. So I kind of consider this this kind of subject, sort of a secret society, because they're it's very little known, you know. But if people want to check out, I try to look into some of the classical conspiracies and kind of go a little bit deeper than like some of the classic conspirators or classic hosts did. I try to like see, okay, what can we prove that's true? Because I love conspiracies, but you know, there are like with any conspiracy, there's all kinds of stuff that people make up, you know, just like everything else. So you kind of really have to parse through a lot of stuff to find out what's provable and what's not. So that's kind of what I try to do. So if people are interested in that, please check it out.
Yeah. And you said it'd probably be a long series too, right?
Yeah. This one, I'm dropping number 3 tonight, and it's all about the Rothschilds and their part in the creation of the modern state of Israel, which is a huge part. It's just going to go on and on, I think, because the amount of notes that I have, and I just keep buying more books about it. So I'm all about it. So it's so interesting to me because this is such a huge subject, you know, it's almost forbidden to even talk about it anymore, you know, but like if you look through like old newspaper, like headlines, even the New York Times, you see Zionism come up all the time. So it was not a kind of a forbidden term back in the day, you know, and I think that just came about maybe in the last 20 years or so. And you see like people on both the left and the right coming out with like legislation where you can't say anything about, basically you can't say anything about anything the Israelis are doing without being labeled an anti-Semite, you know, whether it's the Israeli government, the Israeli corporations, different things like that. So it's really becoming one of those subjects that's all but forbidden to talk about. I think it will eventually be completely outlawed to say anything negative. And I'm a Christian. I've said that in the past, and I grew up in this, I grew up Protestant, and it was kind of like you believed it. Now, you always took Israel's side, you know. That's kind of like what we believed. That was kind of like what we were taught. It was never really heard that specifically, but it was just a given.
I've noticed that, like, so I'm from Canada, right, and raised Catholic, but I never found that we were pushed that way. I don't know if that's, like, an American Christian thing, but I noticed that the last few years, based off of accounts I've followed on social media, like, a lot of the Christian accounts are very pro-Israel, and I'm like, that is very interesting. Yeah, I'm not sure if it's, like, an American thing or what, but...
I think it is an English and American thing. I mean, more American, I think, but it kind of goes back to, from what I can understand, this guy Darby, this preacher, he taught this dispensationalism, which basically means that we always take Israel's side, that they can do no wrong, basically. And then after him came Scofield, and he put these reference notes in the Bible, in the King James Version. And they were basically along the same lines of, you always take Israel's side. They're the chosen ones, and you don't question that, and blah, blah, blah. And he was actually working with the British government, come to find out, and some of those early Zionists. So there's a great book called Scofield and his book or something like that. But anyway, it explains all that, how he kind of I think he was probably getting paid to do that for this very reason. Because the Zionists, one thing I've learned is the organization at the very beginning was unbelievable. They had money because a lot of these European Jews, I mean, they were bankers and lawyers and different things like that, just like they are today. And they had the money to put behind Zionism, you know, so it became a very powerful movement pretty quickly. And, I virtually knew nothing about it when I started looking into it. I kind of got interested about it a few years ago when I think it was Vigilant Citizen, you know, the website. Mm-hmm. He puts out this Sinister series or Sinister Sites series. So he'll have, you know, like these different places, and he'll talk about the esoteric meaning behind some of the symbolism and stuff like that. I think he did one with about Rockefeller Center and numerous ones, but he did one about the Israeli Supreme Court, and I clicked on it, started looking at it, and you know, their Supreme Court is very kind of Masonic looking, and in the center is a big pyramid that sticks up in the middle, and it has a window just like the all-seeing eye.
Hmm.
That has nothing to do with Judaism. So I'm like, what's up with that? You know, it's even kind of got a greenish color a little bit, like the dollar bill, and the rest of the building is more light colored.
That's interesting.
Then there's an obelisk outside. It's a miniature obelisk, probably about maybe 15 feet or something like that. Again, nothing to do with Judaism. But then you start looking into that building and it's like, wow, this is very interesting. Like there's this, stream of water that goes right through the center of the building on the outside.
Oh, wow.
And it ends into this circle. And right there above it is this black stone that's probably, I want to say, 15 feet or 15 inches to 20 inches high, maybe a little bit bigger. It's hard to tell. And maybe, I don't know, 10 inches wide, but it's this beautiful, huge, almost onyx-like black stone that's very shiny.
What?
And, of course, you have black rock and black stone.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Those guys are, you know, like Larry Fink, Jewish. They even, you know, Black Rock owns everything. They even said, I read an article a while back that said that when Black Rock was first getting going, they called Larry's, like, entourage that worked with him, Little Israel. And then the Black Stone came, it was a subsidiary of Black Rock, and it's Steven Schwartzman started it, and he's also Jewish, of course, and he was a Skull and Bones guy. So it's just kind of funny. You keep running into, like, you know, is that connected to the stone that the Masons talk about? Because if you look into the Rothschild's family archive, they talk about how they've been in Masonry for years, you know, so they're pretty open about it. It doesn't have a lot in there about it, but there is down the stairwell. It looks like the Vesica of Pisces.
Oh.
I mean, it's just this perfect shape down the stairwell. They have these big pomegranates outside.
What?
Yeah, I mean, it goes on and on, and it's like nobody talks about this stuff.
Yo, even Israel Righardi has a book called The Pomegranate.
I mean, yeah, I saw that. And I read a couple of, in my latest episode, I read a couple of quotes from, I think, Albert Pike and Manly P. Hall on the symbolism of pomegranates. And I'm like, well, this is not by chance, you know.
No way.
I'm leaving some other stuff out, but it's a very interesting building if anybody wants to look into it. But it was built by the Rothschilds. It was donated by the Rothschilds to Israel.
Of course it was.
Yeah. So
I wonder if they donate money to the Mormon temples that have the all-seeing eye above them. Like, are they funding that?
Yeah.
Because, probably. Like, even their temples, I think above a lot of their doors, they have the all-seeing eye there. Like, what is that? I mean,
yeah.
And a beehive. And a beehive on the doorknob.
Yeah. It's crazy. But, yeah, you know, started looking, you know, into this recently. And I was like, wow, you know, I saw this video of Lord Jacob Rothschild talking about how his family helped create the modern state. And he's very proud of it, and which, you know, which is fine and dandy and everything. But just made me want to look into even more. And so if you look into, I think his name was Benjamin D. Rothschild, and he came from the French Rothschilds, and he started putting money into Palestine at the time, which was under the Ottoman Empire. The Turks ran it, you know, and he started secretly buying land in Palestine. And at the time, this was like mid to late 1800s, there was only like 2% Jews there. It was like 10, 15% Christians, and then the rest were Arabs and Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, it was kind of a secret thing at first. And then he started bringing more and more Jews over there to cultivate the lands. And they would not allow any Arabs anymore to work on the lands. It was like forbidden. Once he took those lands, it was, you know, Jews only. And, but, you know, that was his property, I guess, so he had the right to do that. But they eventually started to acquire more and more land like that over time. And they kind of, they had this, like some of the Turks that owned that land hadn't lived on it in a long time. They just owned it, some of the more wealthy ones. And so they somehow made a law to where it would be like $50,000 for the Turks to keep the land, like this crazy amount per year. And so
some property taxes right there.
By like acre, like, you know, I'm not sure exactly the amount of acreage, because they don't call it acres, they call it something else. But anyway, so eventually the Arabs, they started selling the land. And so that's kind of how it all started. And in the meantime, there was all kinds of stuff happening here in the United States and in England, where they were trying to, a lot of these like Zionists were working secretly in the governments, trying to persuade England and America to help bring about the modern state. And, you know, eventually they were able to get it done, but there was a lot of things happening in between. There was a lot of blackmail eventually.
Of course.
they actually, well, I'm kind of getting ahead of myself here, but one of the Rockefellers, I'm forgetting his name now, the Nelson Rockefeller, you know, he had ran for president, mm-hmm. and they had petitioned him to help form the modern state at one point, and he didn't really want to do it. And they kind of said, well, we're going to tell that the Rockefellers, through Standard Oil, have been selling the Nazis fuel. If you don't do that, we're going to spill the beans. And, you know, he's like, they kind of forced his hand. So he was so influential through the UN and whatnot that he helped get it done. But he actually kind of turned around and kind of blackmailed the Zionists as well. It was kind of like a double blackmail there, because he made a stipulation, okay, I will help you, but we're going to allow a bunch of these Nazis to not be tried in the Nuremberg trials. They're going to get away to
South America,
different place. Yeah. Yeah. And, they're going to be able to get away. So that was kind of the deal, because he was so close with Alan Dulles and a lot of these guys that had been helping the Nazis. So, there was kind of a double blackmail there, but, yeah, it's a wild, wild story. And, the original Zionists were not even, most of them were not even religious. In fact, they believed at the time, and a lot of the Orthodox Jews still believe this, that it would be a sin to force your way into a land by the point of a gun. They believed that God would eventually restore the land, but everybody would be able to enjoy it, almost like it would be heaven to them.
Yeah, or utopia.
Yeah, so like, you know, they believe in the 613 Talmudic laws, and eventually everybody will be reincarnated to the point where they follow the laws, and then we can all go to heaven. And almost like Israel is almost like a paradise, you know. Yeah. Whether that's up in the, you know, somewhere in the heavens or an actual place here on earth, it's not exactly like there's differences on what they believe about that. But people didn't want to go over there early on, like Jews from different parts of the world, because especially the ones that live here in America, they had it pretty good here compared to most places. And so, you know, that they pay people now to go over there. If you're Jewish, they'll pay you to go to live in Israel. They were basically forcing them, though, because, you know, some of the, like FDR and some of the couple of different presidents wouldn't allow Jews to come over here for a time to get away from persecution and all that stuff. And so they kind of worked in the Zionists' favor, because they didn't want them to go anywhere but Palestine. In fact, they would block, they blocked some of the legislation to keep Jews from getting to come to America, because they only wanted to go to Palestine. And not only that, but this Theodor Herzl is the guy who's kind of credited with being the father of Zionism. He was a playwright, and he was a newspaper columnist, and he kind of started the whole movement, or at least he's credited with it. And the Rothschilds got behind him for a time, and he would go to all these places, but he was going to different places in the world asking, can we get a place to have a Jewish homeland? And places like Guatemala, places in Africa, even Texas was a possibility, which would have been a lot better off if Texas, if they just let them go to Texas, because we wouldn't have this Middle East war, you know, thing going on. But yeah, and even like, and Herzl was actually, for all his faults, he was more reasonable than the Zionist organizations, like the World Zionist Organization and these different ones, because a couple of these places, they actually talked the leaders of the government into letting them move there. But then these organizations were like, no, we only want to go to Palestine. And there's even a couple of times where Herzl would kind of argue with them and see, like, they're giving us this land. Why do we not take it? You know, so they believe that they wanted that land. And I think also there is a lot of people don't realize, but it was very mineral rich in that land where the Dead Sea is and in that area. And so that, I think, was a huge thing. I think the Rothschilds realized too that it was a potential moneymaker, and they were able to take, you know, over the utilities and all these different things eventually. And, you know, like, they basically just took over everything, especially after the wars, the first couple of wars there with the Arabs. They just ran the Arabs off and took everything they had. And, you know, that's been that way ever since.
Damn, that was nice.
Crazy.
Not to, oh God, it was just something I wanted to say earlier, and unfortunately it's like going back kind of backwards, but you did mention something about like everything always being anti-Semitic. I've often wondered, I hate to say it, like I do think parts of World War II, the propaganda was probably just as bad as what's going on with COVID. And I do think that to a certain extent, things that happened in World War II, I think, were done on purpose just so you can say, now you say anything about Jewish people, you're anti-Semitic and you're a Hitler. You know what I mean? You can't say a damn thing now because of World War II.
Yeah, I mean, there's even a few quotes by different Zionists who talked about that and said that this would work in their favor. There's even one, I should have brought this up. It's one of the main Zionists, and I don't remember if it's David Ben-Gurion or one of the first PMs of Israel, but he even said that, you know, the old people in Germany and different parts that were being killed by the Germans and the Nazis, you know, they're old. They don't really have anything to contribute. They need young people in Palestine. So it's just part of life. And they actually were blocking the legislation, you know, to help them out. Even like things like aid and stuff like that. So there was this obsession with the land that is bigger than the religion. It's bigger than the politics. It's really strange. It's like the land itself was like is a graven image, I believe. So that's very interesting too.
Yeah, it makes you wonder about, like, is there anything special about that piece of property?
Right.
You know, any ley lines, or is it like, could it be something like Skinwalker Ranch, where there might be like some sort of energy, a portal field or something going on over there that might be useful to some people? That's interesting.
Yeah, yeah, it is. And, you know, they have, like, there's different sects of Judaism. There's Reform Judaism, Conservative Judaism, which is mostly in the States, I think. You have the Orthodox Judaism, which there's different sects within Orthodox Judaism, the Hasids and the different ones. And those guys, on one hand, they make a lot of sense because they're against Zionism. But on the other hand, they get deeply into the Kabbalistic kind of doctrines. And one thing I learned from this one, he passed away a couple of years ago, but he was an Israeli professor. I think he worked at Hebrew University. He was an activist, though. He stood against the Zionism and the especially the more fundamental parts of Judaism, like the Hasids and stuff like that. And he dedicated his whole life to just kind of exposing what they believe. And, you know, if you look into the Talmud is this huge, huge commentary on the first five books of the Bible, because that's all that the Jews believe, and they don't believe in the rest of the Bible. And the Talmud is just all these different rabbis over time commenting on what they think the Bible means. And that's where they get the 613 laws. And it was a long time before the Talmud was ever translated into English, But if you can find the uncensored versions, there's a Sonsino version that's uncensored. You can find it online sometimes. It's got some wicked stuff in it. It's like the most legalistic, just heartless kind of laws. Like, I turned to one the other day at random, and it was talking about if a rabbi's daughter commits adultery, is it better to burn her alive or cut her nose off or stone her?
Oh, wow.
You know, and then you'll see people, like, somebody will say something about one of these horrible things out of the Talmud, and then, you know, so somebody who's Jewish will say, oh, that's a bad translation. That's just some anti-Semitic person making that up. But then you can go and find the uncensored versions yourself, and you realize, oh, this is some horrible shit. This is horrible, you know? So, yeah. And another thing I learned too, from Israel Shahak, the professor I'm talking about, he says in there plainly when they teach, because they go to these schools they call yeshivas, and that's what they send their boys to. I think they never sent the girls to school until the last, like, maybe 30, 40 years, I think. But they barely teach them anything. But the yeshivas for the boys, they're supposed to be about Torah, which is the first five books of the Bible. But they don't really even talk about the Bible. They talk about the Talmud and these commentaries on what these rabbis thought it meant. And it's all kinds of stuff, you know. These rabbis go back and forth. And it, not all of it's bad. You know, some of it, there's some wisdom in that stuff. But, I mean, there's some really bad stuff towards Gentiles, towards women especially.
I was just going to ask, like, women really aren't even, like, supposed to even be studying that stuff, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
And you know what's weird? This almost reminds me, and not again to go back to the Mormonism, but I know you had even said maybe we could have talked about that too or whatever. But, the Bible that they have, I know Joseph Smith added stuff after it came out, but if you look at the stuff that he added, like, into that, I don't know how the fuck the people who were even following it could even be okay with it. Because, like, he ended up adding in some, like, really weird shit, especially his, like, I think Book of Abraham. He goes into, like, child sacrifice and Quetzalcoatl being Jesus Christ, all sorts of weird shit.
What?
Yeah, but it's like, but then the people be like, oh, well, that was added in afterwards. So, like, you know, that was Joseph Smith was just losing his mind. The religion is still, you know. Same thing as, like, you were saying, you know, they make up excuses for it.
It is, man, especially, you know, it says in the Bible that you're not supposed to add or take away any of the words. And if you were a true believer, you would obviously be like, oh, we can't be adding things in there because that would be, right? Yeah, it's crazy. The Mormon thing is one of the craziest things I've ever looked into. I mean, just because it's so modern and how he was able to fool so many people. I mean, the guy had to be a genius. I mean, despite his craziness, he had to be a genius.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I think so. Yeah, or at least an occult genius, you know?
I wanted to ask you, Oddman, so from your, like, research into the Talmud and stuff, I hear a lot of, like, conspiracy people talk about that they want to implement, like, the Noahide laws. Is that the same thing? Does that come from the Talmud? Okay.
I mentioned that the Jews under the Talmud have 613 laws they're supposed to obey. Mm-hmm. And according to these Orthodox rabbis, you know, like I said before, you'll be reincarnated until you are able to follow the law perfectly, and then you'll become enlightened, which I'm sure none of them have ever done ever, you know, so, but I mean, they look up to these rabbis, especially throughout time. Like, they are, I mean, there's literally, they're higher than God. Like, you look into the Zohar in different parts of the Talmud and stuff like that, and they talk about how God asks, like some of them chastise God, and then God will ask them for advice on what to do, stuff like that. And I'm like,
what?
And they believe that some of these rabbis have been reincarnated into other rabbis. And so they collect all these writings and say, well, that was Rabbi Sneerson, or, well, he's more of a modern guy. That was Rabbi Ben Yochai reincarnated is another rabbi and stuff like that.
Wow.
But so the Noahide laws come out of the Talmud, and that's like the seven laws for Gentiles. And I think every one of those laws call for execution if you don't follow those laws.
Yeah.
And so in, I forget now, I want to say 92, 93, George H.W. Bush signed
yes.
those into law, but supposedly it's just like a, like an honorary thing. It's not actual law. And the guy he was honoring was this Rabbi Snierson. I think his name's Mendelssohn Snierson or Mendel Snierson. Uh-huh. And he's the guy who I think is credited with starting the Chabad sect of Judaism, which is a kind of like a Hasidic sect or a Orthodox sect. It's the one that that Ivanka Trump and Jared Kushner belong to. And these guys are hardcore into Kabbalah and the mystical aspects of it. And they're also into these, like, just this Talmudic stuff. It's crazy if you start looking into it. So, you know, it makes you wonder, because almost every time you see these Jewish guys pictured with the president in the Oval Office, it's the Chabad sect. Mm-hmm. And it's always the Orthodox sect. So these guys are a small percentage in Israel, a pretty low percentage, but they have an extreme amount of political power, and they believe in these hardcore Talmudic laws that are just soulless, a lot of them. So it's pretty scary to think about.
Well, you know, I even want to, even from my own experience, I never got into like the Talmud or the Zohar, a little bit of the Sefer Yetzirah, but I know from my experience, and unfortunately, I never got into it because I really only wanted to focus on the Hermetic Kabbalah. I kind of wish I would have, like, done both. But from my experience in ceremonial magic, I mean, people that were huge into the Kabbalah, they read the Zohar, the Talmud, you know, all that stuff, because it does kind of tie in with Kabbalah. So, you know, you're talking about Ivanka Trump. I mean, I hate to say it, but the reason I think that she's probably into that is because they're into occultism. You know, that's the part of the fucking, you know, some team somewhere.
Well, yeah. You know, there is various rabbis I did on my last show in the Reformed and the in the Orthodox sects who believe, they talk about the holy serpent, the holy snake, and they'll say that God is a holy serpent, or they'll say that the holy serpent is man's best friend, that on a certain day you can coax serpents to do your will. They talk about the, like there was this, I always say his name wrong. I think it was Gaon of Vilna. He was a rabbi. I think he was an Ashkenazi rabbi, if I'm not mistaken. But anyway, he wanted to get back to the Holy Land. This was way before, I think it was like 1600s, 1500s. And I think he was the first one to talk about the holy snake, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, just some of the crazy, crazy things that they talk about in there. That's like, okay, where are you guys going with this? The snake part. They believe in the this angel Metatron.
Oh yeah,
yes.
They just made up this angel. I think it came from the Zohar, if I'm not mistaken. I think that Rabbi Ben Yochai is the one that's credited with it, and they have a day, a special day of the year that they honor that guy. Like thousands of people come out in Israel and honor that guy. And he's the one that is credited with coming up with the Zohar. And he wrote some stuff in the Talmud too. But if you actually start looking into the Zohar, they try to say for years, for decades, that it was this ancient book, but it wasn't. Now it's been found out that it was written in like 1300 by this Spanish Jew named, Moses de Leon, maybe. Oh. So that's pretty interesting as well. There's this one Reformed rabbi, Michael Leitman, and he talks about the Holy Serpent as well. And he's a very popular rabbi. Like, he's got a lot of money behind him. And I found this speech he gave over somewhere in Israel. And he was saying in this speech, it's translated right there on the spot, that Jews came from another planet. They have been put here to basically save the world, and it's just the craziest thing, man. I mean, it's like,
again, not to go back to the Mormonism, but if you look at some of their old shit, I mean, they looked like there were people in a fucking spaceship coming.
Sounds like Mormonism. Sounds like Galactic Federation. It's like the same story in like a different package.
I'm honestly. Sure there's a Marvel fucking movie about that too.
Something. Oh yeah,
Transformers. Is there a Metatron in Transformers? I'm
probably Megatron. Yeah. And back to the Metatron, like he's supposed to be like the top angel or whatever. Yes,
especially in the Kabbalah. That, yeah. If you know the sphere at the top of the tree that's supposed to be Kether, God. There's like four different spheres, I guess, you know, four different densities of that sphere. And like Metatron is the archangel right before you get to God. Like he's like, you know, right there. Like he's like fucking top dog, really, out of all archangels on the Kabbalah.
That makes sense because a couple of the things I've read looking into the Zohar, they equate him as being as high as God. So it's like, and you know, it's just crazy because, you know, they just made this guy up in like the 1300s. So, but, you know, it's just, it's wild. I mean,
well, that makes me think of like the idea, sorry to interrupt you, the idea of like the synagogue of Satan idea. And, you know, maybe there is like two warring like bloodlines, perhaps, or, you know, that kind of thing.
I know Adam Green, you know, I heard him say on your show something about the when people talk about the Khazars, the Khazarians, that was bullshit. But I tend to believe there is something to it. And if for no other reason than if you look into DNA evidence that's come out in the last few years, they have figured out that the Ashkenazi bloodline of Jews, you have the Sephardic and the Ashkenazi. And the Ashkenazi make up most of the Jews in the United States. They actually don't, their bloodline, at least 90% of it, doesn't trace back to the Middle East. It's Eastern European. So they're not the Jews from the biblical times. They're just not. So, and there's pretty good evidence that they were the Khazars. And they make up about half of the Jews in Israel, and they are the ones who started Zionism. Mostly it was mostly the Ashkenazi.
And so, I've heard that too, like in regards to the Holocaust, that if you look at the certain, like that maybe it was a certain bloodline that was targeted more so than just Jews in general.
It's really, I mean, there may be
something I heard.
There may be something to that. Well, right? After looking into the, you know, this Zionist history and how heartless they were towards their own people, you know, it was obvious that they only cared about getting into Palestine and having that state, and they didn't give a shit about those Jews who were dying and suffering. And I'm leaving out something huge, too. So there was something called the Havara Agreement, and there's a Jewish author, Edwin Black. I think he's kind of a Zionist, but he wrote a book called The Transfer Agreement. And so it's not just something that, you know, people like me are making up. The Zionists made a deal with the Nazis because I think it was 1933. There was a boycott on German goods by the Jewish Zionists here in America and other places. Well, they decided, you know, at kind of like an exchange, the Nazis, if they'll start encouraging people to get to Palestine, the Jews, they will stop the trade, you know, the trade block. And so they did. They made this agreement that lasted, I think, 6 years. And they were even like promoting and selling Nazi goods at one time, or German goods at one time, the Zionists. So there was an agreement there that you don't hear much about. And not only that, but this one guy, Jabotinsky, he was from Russia. He was a Russian Jew. And he really looked up to Mussolini, who was obviously a fascist, you know, Italian fascist. Mm-hmm. And he became friends with Mussolini. And Jabotinsky started this, I think it was called a revisionist Zionism. So his version of Zionism was hardcore, no pretenses. We're not going to talk about a two-state solution. We want it all. And if you look back, even Theodore Herzl, the guy who started Zionism, and all the leaders at the beginning, they didn't just want what is considered Israel now. They wanted the whole Levant, and they were open about that. You can find their writings about it. And that's what Jabotinsky was about as well. But he actually, he had these guys, and they claim, I've read this in numerous reports, that his, he had this faction of Jews who were basically militant, who trained at Mussolini's, one of his bases, and they were trained by the fascists. They wore black shirts, mm-hmm. like Hitler's brown shirts, and they even gave the Nazi salute. And they even called Jabotinsky, I think they call him the Jewish Hitler. So it's just wild how this stuff's been swept under the rug. And so there was kind of a, some of the Zionists were like, Jabotinsky's too, you know, he's too out there. But then at the end, they ended up, he was buried in New York. They took his body to Israel and buried it at one of the most famous mountains there. So he's held as a big hero now. But yeah, he was all about Mussolini, and they were trying to work with the, they had petitioned the Nazis to try to have a faction that could live amongst the Nazis and even have a an army there of Jews, not supposedly to kill other Jews, but just to exist in Germany among them. So there's so much history that's been lost and just most people don't talk about, and they're afraid to talk about any of it.
Sounds like a quest for a one world government to me.
Yes.
You know,
I find it funny that his name was Jabotinsky and like we got fascist jabs going on right now.
That's right.
For well, sure. Now I remember too, like, you know, researching like Ashkenazi Jews and whatnot. And then it has the word Nazi in it.
Yeah, I blew my mind.
Like, honestly, don't remember like where the word Nazi comes from, but I was like, damn.
You know what's funny? And I was going to bring this up. I have this, and then I have a question I wanted to ask you, Adam. Somebody said, Jonah did comment. He said, "Do you think Nazi equals National Socialism, or do you think Nazi equals National Zionism?" And you're like, oh.
There you go.
That's a good question.
It's just, yeah. Yeah. Another,
you take the first two letters from each word, it does spell Nazi.
Yeah. Isn't that crazy?
Now, in your opinion, these people who kind of started this stuff or were at the beginning, do you think, I know you mentioned before you didn't even think really religious. Do you think that maybe a lot of them neither were occultists or just like this is a good business thing for us and really didn't care about the actual religion of the belief?
Definitely first, I do believe. And because they couldn't get a lot of Jews to even come to Israel. In fact, once America and other places wouldn't take a lot of the Jews, they, and you know, like I said, that in Palestine, they really wanted the younger ones. So they were forced to go there a lot of circumstances. They had no other place to go. And so when they would get over there, they would, first of all, tell them they have to fight the Arabs and they would arm them. If they didn't fight the Arabs, they would not have a place to live. They would not have a way to make money. They might even be flogged or locked away. So they immediately started kind of like militarizing the people that would come over there. But yeah, at first, I mean, you just read time and time again from various sources that there was the religious Jews didn't want anything to do with Zionism. They just did not believe in, you know, because really, I mean, They just didn't believe in violence and in taking it. It sounds
opposed to the faith if you are practicing the faith correctly, mm-hmm. right? It always reminds me of like the passage in Matthew 23 where Jesus goes off on the Pharisees and he's like, woe to you scribes, woe to you Pharisees, you hypocrites. And he calls them vipers, calls them serpents. I was like,
serpents.
Jesus was on some mad shit there.
Well, that's I'm so glad you mentioned that because I didn't want to leave this out. So the more you look into the Talmud and the in what the modern Jews kind of believe, especially these rabbinical Jews, they and let me just say my grandmother was Jewish, so if anybody wants to get mad at me and say I'm, you know, this, that, or the other.
My uncle is too.
I loved my grandma. So but anyway, they are very open about how the Pharisees took over Judaism, and all the Talmudic stuff comes from the Pharisees, the Pharisaical branch. These rabbis talk about this openly. If you read their writings and their conversations with one another. So, you know, if you look at it, I mean, just who was against Jesus? The Pharisees. Who would he talk to all the time and try to call them out on their shit? It was the Pharisees, you know? And so that's, to me, that says a lot. I mean, yeah. You know, you can say you don't believe in Jesus or any of that stuff, but that is, I mean, that's been documented about the Pharisees, you know, for over time. They kept their records. I mean, because they love themselves and what they say so much. They've been really good about keeping the records of the things that they've said over time.
Yeah, I just brought up the passage. It's just interesting. In the one of the verses, it says, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I've longed to gather your children together, but you are not willing."
Mm, yeah, yeah, and you know, it's one thing that right? one of the things that irks me is like you know, being a Christian. You know, I can't hardly even go to church anymore because like these Christian Zionists, it's just pathetic because like. On one hand, they'll do a sermon and they'll talk about how these Israelites turn their back on God time and time again. And then they'll turn around and be like, well, you know, if you say anything about Israel, you are anti-Jewish. You know, you are an anti-Semite. And I'm like, wait a minute. So they were bad back in the day. But now, right. When the world's probably worse than it was then, you're saying they're good now and we have to blindly support everything they do, including the government and the corporations and the
including
banks.
Bombing people. It's fine. That part's fine.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense, honestly.
Yeah, I'll just take this back to Mormonism. That sounds like the Nephites and the Lamanites. One was bad originally, then there was fights between both, and then the bad guys kind of won, technically, because they were considered the bad ones at first, and now they're all of a sudden they're the right ones now. What the fuck?
Isn't it? Yeah. It's crazy, right? Because that leads right back to the Israelites, you know, because he obviously was obsessed with that kind of, at least that's kind of where he got his whole idea for Mormonism, was to spring it off that. It's just unbelievable. Unbelievable. Quickly, let me say, too, that there's a few instances, like people want to talk about, because you know, we've been kind of like brainwashed to believe that Muslims are horrible and since the war on terror and all that. But, you know, there was a group of Jews called the Ergun, and they were this, like, militant organization, and they were bombing and doing all kinds of horrible shit. Like, Menachem Begin, who was one of the main Jewish, I think he was one of the first Jewish prime ministers. Not the very first. I think that was David Ben-Gurion. But he was in this Ergun group. So you had Ergun. I think there's another one. Let me see if I can find it here. But these groups, people don't realize, but so after when the British took over Palestine, you know, they didn't instantly give it to the Jews right away. There were 800,000 or more Palestinians living there. And so anyway, 2% Jews. And they were pissed at the British government because they wanted the British government to just give them everything they wanted. And so these groups like the Ergun, they started doing stuff to the British government in retaliation. There was this plan to blow up the parliament. They hired this this guy who was a airplane pilot to help them to drop bombs on the British Parliament. And he was not going to do it, but he decided, okay, I'll pretend like I'm going to do it. And then I'm going to go to the Brits and tell them, this is what they're going to do to you. And that's what he did. there is the King David Hotel bombing. They killed, I think, 90-some-odd people.
Oh, wow.
You don't hear about that. There is, they bombed the USS Liberty, which is, you know, a U.S. warship that they sank, and you hear nothing about that.
Wow. You didn't use that as an excuse to go to war. You know, there's something behind that.
For sure.
You see here, Ergun, they launched a series of attacks which lasted until the founding of Israel. All told, Ergun attacks against Arab targets resulted in at least 250 Arab deaths during this period. The following is a list of attacks, and it tells you that there were around 60 operations altogether between the 1930s and 40s by that one group. And you know, the one of the leaders ended up being at the head of the Israeli government later on. So, you know.
Well, then. Wow.
Do you think there's any ties between, like, Zionism and the Frankists?
You know, that's something I really want to get into, but I haven't looked into it enough. Okay. I have looked a little bit into the Zabbatai Zvi or Zabbatai Zevi. Yeah. Sometimes they call him Shabbatai or whatever. But and he was like one of those, you know, the one of the Arabs that they, I mean, excuse me, one of the rabbis that they thought was a Messiah. And he was like very popular. Like they said that Jews from all over the world was coming to follow this guy. They were leaving. They're just like giving everything away to come follow this guy. And he ended up turning around and supporting the Muslims in the end.
Yeah.
And they say that people like this guy so much. They, even though he joined the enemies, they refused to turn their back on him. And they say that he still has followers. Oh, so.
Wow.
That's where you get the Sabbateans, I think. But I think they're similar to the Frankists, but I haven't read into Frankism enough to say much about it.
Yeah, no, it's, they definitely have a fucked up thing going on with them, too. Like,
yeah,
if you look into their, like, their ideas and their doctrine, it's basically just, like, to demoralize the humanity. And, like, kind of usher in, like, a, I guess, an end. in a new beginning.
Yeah, you know, I talked about the Rothschilds. They paid for the Israeli Knesset. They paid for the legislative building. They paid for the National Library, the National Memorial Gardens right beside the Knesset. It's named after one of the Rothschilds. There's Rothschild Boulevard right through downtown Tel Aviv. There's numerous places named after different Rothschilds. Rothschild, the first one to help, I think that was Benjamin D. Rothschild. He was on their money. He was on the 500 shekel on coins. There's places, Zion's, I think it's called, or Benjamin's Pool is this beautiful fountain, big fountain that's named after him or dedicated to him. Just numerous things that people aren't aware of. There's a place there that's named after his parents, and it's just crazy. I kind of feel like they figured out, well, you know, we can start our own country. Basically, we can get rid of these Arabs, and we can because there's talk about how they'll and they did this. They said, well, before we really start to gather in the more wealthy Jews, we'll send the poor Jews over and we'll teach them how to hunt, or not hunt really, but to plant and do gardens and different things like that. And then we'll build these, basically these common people who do all the hard work until there's a bit of a economy going there. And then we can bring in the more wealthy people. And so, and again, they, you know, they would not allow anybody who wasn't Jewish to work on any of the lands. So that's been another way that they've been able to really capitalize on that. And, and like in the, I think it was the 60, sorry, I don't have this in front of me. My notes are scattered, but, I want to say 68 when they had a war there, maybe it was 67. They were not supposed to take more land. That was against the laws. You're not allowed to take land, seize land anymore. That was like from the world courts. It was an agreement all the countries agreed to, that they would not seize land like they did back in the day, and they did it anyway. So that's why a lot of people say that the land, it's not theirs, because they got it, you know, through the means of war, and it was against international laws.
Yeah.
I do have a question for you, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Ron Diggity had asked, I guess, have you come across any connections between Zionism, the protocols of the Elders of Zion, and the Priory of Zion? Of Zion?
Maybe? Zion.
Yeah.
I haven't. I have read the protocols a long time ago. I mean, it's a lot, but I read it. But I haven't seen a connection between those two. I'd like to know more about the, was it the Priory of Sion? Is that what he said?
Yeah, that and the Protocols of the Elders of Zion.
Yeah, that's like a book or a set of writings that was supposed to be like the plans that the Zionists or the Jews were going to do to be able to take over the world. And a lot of people say it was fake. I assume it was fake, but man, if you start looking through it, a lot of that stuff has happened, and it's kind of like, you know, it's just like, how do these people predict all this? And they also have something called Tikkun Olam, and that is what they believe is the restoring of the world to make it right. That's just, I think that's a Jewish belief throughout all the different sects. Of course, you could, you know, you could say that that's a really good thing, or you could say that's some kind of New World Order, Great Reset type of stuff. But he does go back to that one Rabbi Lateman saying that they were from another planet sent here to make things right in the world.
And it's fucking Thor. And also, I want to ask you, just because I, like, again, like I said, I don't know much about this. So, I mean, from what I could be wrong, what I understand, Zionism is kind of something that came from the Jews, right?
Yes.
Or supposedly, yes. Supposedly they were Jewish. We'll just put it that way. Yeah. So, like, yeah. I've never understood, and maybe you can explain it for me better. How is there Christian Zionism? You know, well, what I'm saying? Because I would almost be like, yeah. well, we're going with, like, now you're not Christians. Really, wouldn't you be Jewish if you're going by Jewish beliefs? So I never understood how there's, like, you know, that those two are mixed. I don't get that.
Yeah, so, well, you know, the early church fathers didn't believe in that. And if you look at Martin Luther, he's got a book called The Jews and Their Lies. And so I'm not saying I agree with all that. I'm not against all Jews or anything like that. I'm against the people in power, trying to take over the world or take over power that they shouldn't have. And that's all I'm against. But, you know, obviously, if Martin Luther didn't believe in that, where did this come from? And it came from the, like I said, the Darby and Schofield. There was another reverend, which I should have mentioned this earlier, called Blackstone. I forget his first name. He was one of the early Christian Zionists. And so you've got, you know, Black Rock and Black Stone.
First, I have to wonder, his name.
Yeah, exactly. Jeez. It's like, what the hell?
I can't with this.
So, you know, these guys were just, I mean, it wasn't just that. They, the Rothschilds and others, started getting into these different churches and different missionary schools. And so they were able to kind of plant this idea of basically defending Israel no matter what, at all costs, in the minds of future generations. And that's been going on now since the late 1800s. Zionists were behind it. And that's how you've got so many Christian Zionists. They believe that they're doing what's right under God just by, you know, protecting the Jews. That's what they believe. But I guarantee you, even the ministers, most of them have no idea about any of this stuff we're talking about. They don't believe it. They don't know that what these rabbis believe. And we've just touched the surface on crazy stuff like the Holy Serpent and stuff like that. I mean, there are some crazy beliefs. So I think they just good propaganda, dude. Good propaganda with millions and millions of dollars spent on perfecting it and spreading it around.
You know, you mentioned that thing with the snake. That reminds me of Moses and his story.
Yeah, yeah.
Which, I mean, well, and not to, I'm not trying to knock whatever was in the Bible, but I did have somebody even say, I think it's, with the amount of people that were there, I mean, when he was holding up that snake, could the guy all the way in the back of all these people actually see that? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, you would need a billboard for everybody there to actually see the snake in it.
Right, yeah, yeah.
So I just, well, you know, it's just weird again with the snake.
And it is, and, you know, obviously the snake is a sign in some cultures of wisdom, you know, and I don't have a problem with that, you know. But it is kind of funny, though, that, you know, according to the biblical story, you know, God told, because all these Jews were getting bit by snakes in the desert and they were dying, and God told Moses to put the, you know, make a staff with a, I think it was a copper snake on it, yeah. And it would keep them from dying or whatever, getting sick. And they began to worship that that picture, that symbol. They begin to worship that as a god. Mm. And so God chastises them. It's like, no, that was meant to save you. That wasn't meant to be a god.
It's like, I made that. Duh.
So,
and you said it was made of copper?
I think that's what I've read. Yeah, a copper looking kind of snake. Yeah.
That's interesting because that does go with the Netzach sphere. And some people will look at that as kind of like maybe a illuminating or Lucifer type thing. So
it's very interesting. Right? Yeah.
You know, which people could mistake and worship instead.
Yeah.
So yeah.
That's interesting.
I always wonder if like all this stuff goes as far back as like the garden story and even like back to like Cain and like Canaanites. Like I think it always just goes right back to there, you know, in terms of like who the Pharisees were or like the synagogue of Satan idea, like Zionism. Like, does it all really stem from like the same either bloodline or group, or it's like an energy or a thought that certain people latch onto, perhaps? I don't know. That's where my mind goes with it, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
You know, in your opinion, I mean, do you think like Zionists are pulling strings, like serious strings still now to this day? And absolutely. Also, like, what's your thoughts? Because, like, I know a lot of people will say that Trump and like Ron DeSantis is Zionist, too. So, I'd like your idea on that, too.
I believe they have more power than we were able to find out because they've been doing this now for 130, 40 years. They are, I would say, the dirtiest players in the game. Mm-hmm. They're smart as hell. I think if you just think about, they are willing to win by any means necessary. From everything I've read, that proves it to me. The ends justify the means. So I think they're absolutely, because think about it, they're 2%, about 2% of the population here in the United States are Jewish. Okay. Now, if you look at the amount of Jews who have had important positions in government and who are influencers in all forms of media, including the news and everything else, entertainment for sure, it's a very strange, it's a very strange percentage.
It's disproportionate.
It's disproportionate. So, I think that look at talk radio. I listened to right-wing talk radio for years, and Michael Savage was Jewish. Michael Medved's Jewish. Shapiro, of course, is Jewish. What's the guy he says he's a Christian, but he's got this university. What is that guy's name? The gray hair and the glasses. I'm forgetting his name now. But I know that there's at least, what was the one guy who was so influential like in the 80s and 90s with the website?
Rush,
he curated news. No, Rush talked about him all the time.
Oh, okay.
I think it was something report.
I don't know.
You guys know what I'm talking about. Crap. But anyway.
Not Levine, is it?
No, Levine, of course, is Jewish. There's another one. He's very influential. There's a bunch that are Jewish, you know, and, I agree with some of the things they're saying, but they will not talk about anything that Israel's doing. Israel's always right. The Muslims are always evil, you know. The wars are always good. So it's like...
Well, and know, even like Edward Bernays, the quote-unquote father of propaganda, is Jewish himself.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely. Absolutely. I've got this whole list I've been going through and just looking at the names and seeing who was Jewish and who wasn't in government positions and media and stuff like that. I've got the longest, craziest list, and I should have put this up here, but I didn't really plan on talking about it. But
oh, is like, it Rappaport? Rappaport. Was that the guy's name you were thinking of before?
No.
Sorry.
Gosh,
sorry to interrupt you.
He was like the goat. The Drudge Report, Matt Drudge.
Oh,
Matt Drudge
is
Jewish. Sorry about that. I couldn't think of his name. So, and the Drudge Report was so influential.
I was going to say that was big when it first came out.
Yeah, so big. So it's like, it's kind of odd that there's so many very influential guys like that in right wing talk radio, and they won't, of course, say anything about Israel. is like they might talk about some of their fellow Jews here in the Democrat Party, but you know, even that they don't really talk too much about. So, you know, I think there's something there, even if it's not an organized plan. I think it's just one of those things where we're not going to say anything bad about our promised land, you know. And when, you know, let me say this to people too, who are, and you think that I'm a horrible anti-Semite or something like that. We're talking about a government. We don't even trust our own government. So why would we trust the Israeli government? And we don't know who those people are. We don't know what they've done. We don't know what, you know, who they're loyal to. We don't know what businesses they're invested in. And then you look at, I mean, Israel is, they make money hand over fist just as a country on their goods, their tourism. They're one of the richest countries. To be that small, they're filthy rich. And we give them $3.8 billion of our tax money. They get about eight, almost $9 billion in loan guarantees from us.
Oh.
I'm sure they get other things. So, you know, we should be able to vote on their, in their elections.
Yeah, right?
Much money to give to them.
Isn't it crazy how much, I mean, if we were to just turn that money around and donate it to our own country, you know how much fucking shit that would fix?
It'd be unreal.
I mean, just the amount of money that we sent to Ukraine, you know what we could have done for this country?
Oh. Yeah, I just saw like 4.5 more billion was promised. I mean, we're getting into the, I don't know how much it's been now, dude. It's unbelievable.
Yeah. Where does it even come from? Like,
yeah, right? Where the fuck does that money go, come from? Where is it going?
Like, we could have used it for so many other things, right?
And, I mean, mm-hmm. honestly, I don't even understand that whole fucking thing. I mean, not that I want to get into it much, but I mean, we have this thing that's like probably what the fucking size of Texas going against Russia. Like, and you haven't gotten demolished and turned into a Disneyland yet? Get the fuck out of here. Come on. It doesn't take this long to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you still got, like, business dealings that you have still together. So, man, how fucking serious is this?
Exactly. You know, you know, and this kind of figures in here. I saw, I think it was 2019 or 2020, there was a big business deal with Ukraine, Ukrainian government, and the Israeli government for a free trade agreement. And had a picture of Zelensky and Netanyahu together. And then if you look at, because we're talking, you know, a few minutes ago about do I think they still have power? Well, if you look in Russia, there's a street named after Vladimir Putin in Russia. There's some kind of children's, like, it's like this place where children go to do all these cool things. Like, it's named after Vladimir Putin. There is, another thing I saw recently too. We're talking about the Chabad group and that Rabbi Sneerson that Ivanka and Jared went to pray to the night before the elections. So they saw that Rabbi Sneerson. He was considered a Messiah too. The Jews believe in two Messiahs. They didn't think Jesus was a Messiah, but they do believe in two Messiahs. And they thought that he was a Messiah. And he, you know, the Chabad sect there, they made some kind of deal with Putin and they moved the museum, the Chabad Museum, to Russia. And that's a huge deal because the Chabad sect are so powerful. So I thought that was shady too. Like, I think these world leaders are bumping hammers. And I think that they're fooling the people.
Yeah.
I think that they are funneling money. I think it's a big money scheme. And, you know, the people, the average people and these soldiers they send out to kill each other are the ones paying for it. And, you know, I think these wars are, half of them, I think, in modern day are just used to get what they want, you know, because they can get away with so much under the guise of war and they can get their, you know, their photo ops and their video ops. And it's just crazy, man.
Yeah, I really do think that whole shit over in Ukraine really is just, I mean, when we covered the Azov battalion, who again, like I said, is even big with sending us video footage of what's going on over there. You know, I've seen it on at least three different news stations that even when they're showing us the footage in the bottom, it says, you know, supplied by Azov, or even has their fucking website on there. But like, you know, when we covered them, like they also recruit people from, I don't understand this, and I'm thinking maybe because it's like a traveling thing. Soccer players, they have like two different teams that they recruit from. and they recruit like ultras that are pretty much like people that do like this outlandish choreographed stuff at soccer games. It would almost be like, what are those things here where it's like you could be walking in the middle of like, you know, town square and all of a sudden everybody starts fucking doing something together.
Like a flash mob.
Yeah. Like almost like shit like that. And it's like, are you recruiting them so they can do all the bullshit fucking choreographed stuff in the streets we're seeing that's supposedly going on? Like, why are you recruiting people like that for Azov Battalion? Like, what does that have to do with them being qualified to battle? Probably nothing. It's the propaganda piece that we need to see them doing.
Right.
It's fucking weird.
I never thought I would, you know, we would come to the point where so quickly where all people like us who didn't agree with the Democrats were constantly called Nazis and stuff like that to the Democrats defending Nazis. Yeah. I mean, it happened so quick. It's like
some serious social engineering.
Yeah, sure. So, mm-hmm. I mean, I watched, I think it was either Vox or Time. It was a documentary about Azov and that whole thing from like 2019. And they had this festival where they were recruiting these guys. And this looked like freaking Lollapalooza or something like that. I mean, it looked fun, but like they were recruiting these Azov type of battalion guys. And of course the documentary was making it look horrible, but you know, now they probably would be like, oh, this is great.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Oh, yeah. What was that? There was something you had sent me and told me to watch, and I watched it. Was that the one with Stone that Stone did? That documentary? Wasn't there a documentary about the stuff going on over
here? Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, that's where I
found and I wonder about Oliver Stone. I've always kind of wondered about him, you know. And his son's a little, I'm like a little suspicious of him too, Sean. But, you know, I can't really disagree with most of the stuff the documentaries on Russia and Ukraine said, because it's, you can prove it. I mean, you know, and I don't trust Putin. I've said that outright. I mean, I feel kind of like these guys are, or like we were saying a few minutes ago, I feel kind of like it's a charade and they're kind of like just the faces of it, you know, trying to pretend like they hate each other. And
totally,
you know, I mean, the Democrats were fine with Vladimir Putin, you know, when, under Obama's first term, Hillary and Bill, you know, they were taking money from the Russians. She was meeting with Putin. They did the Uranium One deal. The Clintons were in on this deal with Russia to create their version of the Silicon Valley over in Russia. They had this big deal, all these tech companies. It was going to be the Russian Silicon Valley. And the State Department freaked out. They were like, what the hell? You can't be doing that. They're not exactly our allies. So they liked the Russians back then, you know, but now most evil people in the world.
Yeah. We're back to the Cold War again.
Yeah.
I found that so weird when all that happened. It was like trying to re-trigger like people's subconscious from the 80s and 90s. It was like, okay, we're back to Soviets are bad.
Yeah, the Soviets are bad. We got monkeypox instead of
AIDS. I know, AIDS is bad. Yeah. I'm like, geez, what year is it, man? Like, it's a time warp.
Yeah, remember, I think I said that recently. It's like they took the 70s and 80s, the Cold War. I mean, the Cold War, I guess, was still going on, and then AIDS, and they just smushed it together right now.
Just like, whoa. What
the fuck?
CERN is acting up. What is going on?
Yeah, we happen to be young enough to where we remember that shit.
Jump timelines, honestly.
And the older people, I think that at least the older people, I'm not a spring chicken, but people older than me, you know, who were really remember that shit well. It, like you said, it triggered something in them, because you see people on Twitter and they're like all about exposing this, you know, the official narrative on the and all kinds of shit. But then when the whole Russia Ukraine thing happened, it was kind of like they went back to hating Russia immediately. And I'm like, yo,
it's like
you question all this other stuff.
Yeah, it's like their subconscious got triggered. There was no Russian vodka in the liquor store here in Ontario. I'm like, are you guys for real? How is that going to stop anything?
Took the vodka
nonsense.
Out?
Yeah, they took, like, for a time. I don't know if it's still like that.
Oh, you know what's funny? So. I think, odd man, maybe I could be wrong, but like, wasn't there countries and maybe ours that actually boycotted and said they won't receive certain shit from Russia anymore either, right? And I think vodka was one of them.
Yeah,
I think it was.
That made me think of that movie Scrooged, when his old boss comes in and he's like, you're a hallucination. brought on by poison vodka by Chernobyl or some shit like that. Poison Russian vodka.
Honestly.
Yeah, we can't take it now. It has Chernobyl in it.
And for us to do that after all the shit we've done during the war on terror, can you imagine if countries held, you know, us to that standard? I mean, not us. We didn't have anything to do with it. But you
know America.
I mean.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
It's like, I don't know. People have such a short attention span. It's really scary.
Yes. They bank on that for sure. You know?
Definitely.
Yeah.
Was there anything else that you would like to cover, Oddman? I mean, we're getting like, you know, kind of already past the hour.
If there's anything else you want
to hit on, go for it. Or not, we can always
come back. I'm sure there probably is. There's all kinds of stuff. I promise if we talk about this again, I'll have my notes all together better. Right. I have so much information that I'm having a problem really putting it in an order. But
it's a huge topic for sure.
It really is. Mm-hmm. So if anybody is interested in this,
check out your show. You've already dropped three. You're going to be dropping three. You already have two. Now the third one tonight, you said, right?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And thank you for that. So I'll just show a couple of books that I think that for starters, let me see. The Hidden History of Zionism. It's a short book, but if you really want to get, like, this guy's got everything documented. So really good book to take you like a day and a half if you're really got the time, like, to, you know, like for a few hours, you can read the whole thing.
You could do it like you do. You listen to it on an app.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Or get it like this. I can't get this.
There we go. Good, right there.
Against our better judgment. Yeah. Really good. And that lady's got a website. It's called ifamericansknew.org, I think. And one more.
Sounds good.
Now, this is the Israeli professor who passed away a few years ago, but I told you he spent his whole life kind of fighting this stuff. And he's got some great books, but this one is called Jewish Fundamentalism in Israel.
Mm.
And it's so good, man, because you don't even have to spend that much time reading to realize, holy crap, this stuff's been documented. And it's so obvious that there's some really bad things going on, but we just don't hear about it here. So. The information I've got to do the series were from Jewish authors, mm-hmm. and they just say that they're self-hating Jews. That's what they get called.
Oh, wow.
So like there's the Holocaust Industry is another book by Norman Finkelstein. I think he's from New York. He's Jewish, obviously. And he wrote all about how all these Jewish organizations were profiting off of the Holocaust wrongly by, you know, exploiting and manipulating it. And a lot of the Jews who did come from Germany weren't getting the help they deserved and were promised by these organizations. These organizations were keeping the money and stuff like that. So, yeah, So there's some good stuff out there. You just have to look for it.
Yeah, there's a Canadian Jewish psychologist. Probably a lot of people are familiar with his name, Gabor Mate. He's, I don't know if you've ever seen his videos. He was a baby in World War II, but he's talked about how he was formerly a Zionist and why he's not anymore.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so his videos are pretty cool if anyone wants to check them out online.
Nice.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds good. Yeah, well, thank you, Oddman, for coming on. Like I said, this is a topic that I really don't know much about myself. So I could definitely have you on again. And like I even said, maybe we could do like a series on the Occult Rejects since you're going to have plenty of your own episodes still coming out.
Yeah, absolutely, man. I'm gonna, the show that drops tonight is just a lot of information about the Rothschild in Israel. And I do get into some other things as well. But then probably the next one will be more about these those groups that I told you about that kind of touched on that committed different terrorist acts. And also the massacres that basically right after, once the Jews got settled there, they started trying, you know, taking more lands. And they would pull these massacres on these Arabs sleeping in tents in the middle of the night. I mean, it's pretty horrible stuff, but we'll talk about that a little bit because I think that stuff needs to be exposed. One of the leaders of that massacre ended up leading the Israeli government later on too, so, or the Dur Yin massacre, that one specific one. So anyway, Thank you for having me. It's been awesome, man. And awesome. I hope that I wasn't too scatterbrained.
No, it was really interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. And but yeah, the people listening right now on the lives, if you liked it, I would definitely suggest to go over to his show and check out the other stuff. By the time this drops on my actual podcast, it might be like 6 or 7 weeks from now. So I suggest that you actually, I'm sure he'll have more than three parts by then. Definitely go check out his show. Because I think you said you might end up being like 6 or 7 parts, right?
Yeah, it's definitely going to be for sure.
So definitely, people listening, if you found this interesting, go over to his channel, and I'm sure you'll find a shit ton more than what he just covered on here. Thank you again. Like I said, I thank you for whenever you come on. It's always great. It's always a ton of information, and you know, I always appreciate what you can bring to my show. So just thank you for coming on regardless. Thank you, Teresa, for coming on and joining as well. You know, at least to get another perspective or different questions that I would normally ask. Thank you very much. A great
co-host.
You're welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Oddman, do you want to plug your show one more time just in case people didn't hear it at the beginning?
Yeah, thank you, man. It's The Oddcast. It's The Oddcast FT, The Odd Man Out featuring. But if you want to just go to theoddmanout.podbean.com, that's the show. And underscore The Odd Man Out on Twitter or Instagram.
Yeah, I think I have right now in the show notes, I have your Podbean. I think you have a Linktree, right, or a website?
The Linktree, I got kicked off Linktree. They said I violated the terms of service. I'm like, how in the world do you violate?
They don't like your links.
With nothing but links to show their buttholes, and I can't have it. I don't understand. It was just my social media links. That's all it was.
Gosh.
That's so true, though. It's a funny way to put it. Well, showing the buttholes, but can't talk about this.
Controversial thought content.
Holy shit. So, I guess I do have his links in there. If you don't click on the link tree, it's no good. I'll have to take that out. Yeah, his notes are already in the bottom. Teresa, would you like to plug your show real quick before?
Yeah, so people can check out Spiritual Gangsters with you and me on YouTube, Apple, Spotify. I think you have my link tree there. I think yes. So. Yeah. So yeah, and come check me on Instagram. Let's be friends on there too, right?
Sounds good.
Cool.
Awesome. So yeah, so thank you both for jumping on, and that is the end of another NY Patriot episode. The next live I will be doing, I think, will be Friday morning. We got Roberta Glass coming on covering Nixon for Freaky Fridays. So everybody check that out. And again, like I said, go check out Odd Man stuff if you like this. I'm sure the three episodes he covered are much more in detail than what he just did here. I'm just going by the time that he spent. So go check that out. And until the next one, everybody be well. Later.